Right now is the company's CEO, Andrew Liveris. Andrew, good to see you. Thanks so much for joining us.
Nice to be with you, Maria.
We're really seeing a change in terms of the benefits in corporations, which I'm going to get to in a moment. But first, let's talk about the global economy, given this is front and center and the worry for global markets. How do you see things?
Well, so, Maria, the low oil price scenario that has unfolded through 2015 and then the general commodities issue that has occurred that's hurting emerging economies in terms of their revenue streams, we've always said at Dow that the portfolio we build should benefit from low-priced commodities if we have value-add inputs, outputs, which means technologies and products that people will buy no matter what happens to the economic situation. We're seeing that. Demand is being stimulated by low commodity prices. Now, it's slower than what we would otherwise see. Clearly, a big chunk of the gasoline price that went down went into savers' pockets first. But it's coming out of the pocket now. It's coming out of the wallet.
Is it? Because I've been trying to track this, and it doesn't feel like people are actually spending the money that they saved.
Just go talk to the car manufacturers to answer that question, to the appliance manufacturers, to the furniture and bedding manufacturers, who we sell to. And not just US. This is a global conversation I'm having with you. We are seeing a pivot of very large export economies, notably China's, okay, and some of the other emerging world economies, like the Southeast Asian ones, to internal consumption drivers, benefited from this low oil price, low commodity environment. So the stimuli that we all would want to happen through low-cost inputs, okay, slow as it has been to come, in our view, the real economy is doing fine, thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. So the real economy then is not necessarily in step with what the global markets are telling us. So we've lost $2 trillion in market value, worst year ever in terms of the beginning of a year.
Well, so, you know, as someone told me when I first got the job, you know, the worst thing I could be doing as a CEO is follow the daily stock price and look at the Yahoo chat boards on the messaging system.
Smart advice.
Smart advice, right? Yeah. So you run a company, not a stock. You run it for over cycles. Equity cycles have gotten way, the betas on equity cycles based on fast money and money movements and recalibration of PE ratios. Maybe that's what's happening right now. Mm-hmm. Maybe people are saying, well, maybe the future earnings is not going to be as robust as it was, you know, as we our models said. So we're going to recalibrate the P/E ratio from 17 to 15. There's your $2 trillion, right?
Yeah.
So there could be some of that. And that's what money does. It recalibrates to the future. But in terms of real demand, I want to remind everyone that oil price was considered high at $30 when I first became CEO.
Yeah.
In fact, we were having crisis meetings in Dow because oil had gone to $30. So just a second here, okay? Just back off a bit. Look at the fact that you've got low-cost inputs around the world to some very economies that are big consumption economies like China's, like Europe's, that need these low-price inputs.
Yeah.
And demand will come. And as long as demand is there, then the real market should do just fine.
Yeah, I mean, you have to believe that at some point this is going to be a huge positive for consumers and for businesses. Well, one group that's certainly focused on the short term are activists who were successful in pushing a combination. I want to ask you about Dow Chemical and DuPont right now, because people are looking at this combination to own over the long term. What are the best sort of cases out of this combination, and where do you see growth coming from?
So, as maybe has been definitely reported, I'm not sure about yourself, but you may have read or seen that this has been a 10-year mission to get the industrial logic of these two great, historic, iconic American enterprises.
Truly historic.
So if you could figure out a way to actually put like and like together for the benefit of growth and customers, this is the way to do it. Because DuPont's been on a march to become the number one agricultural science company in the world for a long time. And we've had an agricultural science business that people have talked to me about, including activists, why are you owning it? It belongs somewhere else. And that's been very clear, and we've always said that that's true. So this combination that we're creating, the industrial logic of putting the assets together, getting the cost synergies of the combination, but then very quickly spinning out a pure ag play to become the number one ag science company in the world, the new DuPont.
Real value creation.
Value creation for farmers. They can have literally everything they want in the pantry, forgive the pun, in terms of agricultural science capabilities. We toured the facilities last week, Ed Breeden and I. They're fantastic. I mean, state-of-the-art technology for farmers. The materials science company, they'll become the new Dow. Polymers, materials for packaging, transportation, construction, infrastructure, very focused company. Have low-cost feedstocks and high-tech outputs. That's the new Dow.
Yeah.
And then a very small specialty products company. We've been talking about this for years. Now, what's enabled it? is bringing together these two companies. I think shareholders were demanding some change in the asset orientation, and including the activists. I definitely would say that.
Sure.
But it took really literally two CEOs to check their egos at the door and say, what's the best thing for shareholders for the long term, employees, customers, and the growth that will come from this.
Good for you. When do you expect that growth to start showing up?
So real demand, I mean, so job one, two, and three is run the business as if this merger is not going to happen. Get the merger to close as fast as possible through dedicated teams. Ed and I are weekly working on this. We have daily meetings and a lot of things going on together with our teams. Get to the close and get to the spins within, let's call it a 12 to 24 month time frame. So during that period of time, business as usual. After we join together, get the spins ready, business as usual for the spins. Spins are out, let's call it end of 17. The companies are growing in their new spaces.
Yeah, and a dominant force within the industry.
Yeah, I mean, you know, people like me don't use
the
word.
You don't want to use the word dominant.
Yeah, but we. how about category maker, category builder, category company that'll dominate in the sense of being the number one provider of technologies for those markets.
Global leader and certainly historic. It's really an unbelievable deal. Congratulations
thank you. Thank
to you,
Maria.
Andrew. Good to see you.
Good to see you
thank
as
you
always.
So much.
Not at all.
Andrew Liveris there.